I'm grateful for Richard not coming through the resume. I also want to note that her block said that the role that I will play is the role that I will play, meaning that being a rabbi, all you have to do is shout out a word and I'll do 20 minutes. Also, the classic rabbinic maneuver is that before I begin speaking, I say a few words. So, consider this story of a group of hikers. They start off in one village, they're gonna travel through woods and hill and dale along rarely trodden paths to another village. They set off, they discover that the hills, the dales, the curves, and so forth are much, much longer than they ever expected. It's getting late in the day, and they reach a complex intersection where a number of roads and paths come in and out, and the signpost that would tell them exactly where their destination is has blown over. They're a bit upset because they're in the middle of the woods, and they have no idea where they're going to stay that night if they can't get to their destination. And then one of them has a wonderful idea. They'll pick up the signpost, they'll have the sign pointing toward where they had started, point on the path that they had been, and then they will figure out the path that they have to travel. From this we learn that every once in a while, if you want to figure out how to go forward, you have to look back. And that is the task that has been given to me, to talk about Zionist forward in the spirit of Balfour, looking back at the Balfour Declaration. So let me bring up three features of the creation and development of that declaration that might be useful as setting the groundwork for the challenge that is still before us. Consider first that Herzl, at the initial World Zionist Congress, noted the significance of drawing international recognition for the Zionist cause, and then therefore gave off the next 5 years, and pretty much his life and well-being, to the effort at getting Germany and the Ottoman Empire to recognize a space for Jews in the land of Palestine. Unsuccessfully, but nonetheless, 20 years later, Chaim Weizmann is successful. He establishes exactly what Herzl wants, that is the basis of international recognition for a Jewish homeland. And though England then over the next 20 years, step by step, moves away from that initial commitment to finally, by the time of the White Paper of 1939, has pretty much turned its back on the declaration that Lord Balfour had signed. Nonetheless, England had given the cover and the support that the Zionists need to create the sorts of institutions and organizations in the land and internationally that allowed them, even with the disabilities of the Holocaust and World War II, to move forward. One cannot underestimate how significant that Balfour Declaration was in the creation of the State of Israel. And it was precisely that notion of international recognition. Ahad Ha'am, writing about the Balfour Declaration just a couple of years after it had been signed, noted that Weizmann initially wanted the language of the declaration to be that the British would view with favor the restitution of Palestine as the national home of the Jewish people. The language, however, is to facilitate the establishment in Palestine of a national home. This is a significant difference, as you can tell. It was the expectation that the Jewish home would be Palestine rather than the Jewish home would be a part of Palestine. But nonetheless, and quite significantly, with that declaration, the Jewish leadership, the Zionist leadership, took that to heart and understood that what they could get was what they could get. We recognize that most powerfully in the 1947 resolution, whose anniversary is only 2 weeks from today, roughly 2 weeks from today, of the UN partition plan that the Zionist leadership immediately accepted it, even though it was at best half a loaf in terms of the original hopes for what would be the Jewish homeland. And again, on the eve of the Six-Day War, the conversations that went with Jordan that keep Jordan out of the hostilities, even at the loss, potential loss of the possibility of unification of Jerusalem and acquisition of further lands, as turned out. This pragmatic spirit, which was accepted initially by Weizmann and those who supported him, took place. That if it wasn't a whole loaf, a half a loaf would be sufficient. Finally, the Israeli historian Tom Segev noted that Arthur Balfour and David Lloyd George, the Prime Minister of England, Balfour wrote the declaration, but it was on behalf of the government, including the Prime Minister. They represented a class in, of British society that was comfortably anti-Semitic and held to the position that Jews held an excessive amount of secret power, financial and political, in the world, and that one of the important elements of the motivation for signing that declaration is that in the midst of World War I, it was important that the Jews be on the British side and not give over whatever great influence was imagined that they had to England's adversaries. Not only Germany on the war, but even France, because Sykes and Picot were already talking about how to slice up the Middle East between British and French influence. Now, what do we draw from these three elements that will serve us in looking forward from today as Zionism forward? What are the challenges that we learn? Well, the first is that the Zionism and the Zionist movement cannot be encapsulated upon itself. We're not an echo chamber. We operate within the larger world. This was recognized initially by Herzl. It was brought into practical reality by Weizmann, that it is impossible for the Zionist movement to move forward without the support of friendship, not only of those who are given over to being friends, but those who have political influence and are significant players in world politics. It is therefore no accident that every once in a while the American Zionist movement must come down to Washington, D.C. and have a conference. We don't meet within the great leader-speaking city of New York all the time. Secondly, though Herzl did say, "Im tirtzu, ein zo agadah," if you will, it is no dream, it is no agadah. Nonetheless, what Herzl's failure and Weizmann's success points out that just because you dream it doesn't mean it comes to fruition unless you pragmatically and strategically work it through. And the pragmatism is the critical element. You don't necessarily get everything. Once more, going back to 1897, one might take note of the diaries of both Herzl and second-in-command at the World Zionist Congress, Max Nordau. Herzl thought that it was a successful Congress, but it would still be at least 50 years before a Jewish national home would be established. Nordau thought it would be 300 years. Well, Herzl was accurate in that 50 years later, the State of Israel does indeed come into existence. But the State of Israel still has not been able to establish itself exactly as the Zionist dream would hope. It is not Liyot Am Chofshi, Bayard Singer. It is not being a free people in our land. We know the pressures, we know the terrors, we know the difficulties. So that we're still between Herzl and Nordau. And the challenge is still to be found not just merely in the founding of the state, but how the state might move forward in order to achieve its Zionist dream, and not merely to think about this in terms of the dream itself, but what are indeed the practical steps, what is possible. The ought must always be an is. And finally, Weizmann exploited the innate anti-Semitism of Balfour and Lloyd George to a higher and critical purpose, namely their willingness to sign that declaration and to establish the basis, not only in words, but initially in deeds that allowed for the development of the Jewish state. But the very fact of the way in which Herzl goes about it highlights the still fraught and difficult question of exactly what do we mean by a Jewish state? What is the content of Jew and Judaism? And it is worth noting that from the first World Zionist Congress to this day, and moving on into the forward, that is still an extremely important question. So I'll conclude with this. First, a pop quiz. Which would you rather take to work, the bus or your lunch? To which, of course, we know, why not both? The political scientist Daniel Elazar once noted that Ben-Gurion and Menachem Begin both were deeply affected by the Jewish war against Rome, but they drew two very separate lessons from it. Ben-Gurion drew the lesson that you cannot successfully go against the dominant world power, that one must always have a good relationship with the dominant powers in the world. And Begin drew the lesson that Jews must find ways, overcoming their political and ideological differences nonetheless, to form some sort of reconciliation and unity, even at the loss of one's own specific wishes and dreams. That's the lunch and that's the bus. That as we move forward, we must be willing to both pursue our own visions and listen to those who oppose us in order to, like Ben-Gurion and Begin, create a viable Jewish state, but now to fulfill the words that we find at the end of our Israel's national anthem, to be a free people in Zion and Jerusalem.